I see the setting of the sun and the regret on the seabirds.
The goodbye of friends long gone and the whispers of the wind.
Cooling the warmth of summer love.
I see the sign from a friend far gone.
And wish for the knowing of those who misunderstand.
I send a token of respect and self to where I cannot be and welcome the night birds.
The school is the sun.
We are the birds.
You are the friend.
When me and Tony talk, when me and Marshall talk, when Marshall and Tony talk, we can't ever talk for any length of time without Yale Summer High School coming up.
This was a time out of time. This was an island that none of the kids had ever known existed.
People were coming of age, and there were epiphanies happening all over the place.
The 8 weeks that we spent at Yale Summer High School were like a zip file. So much was compressed into such a short amount of time.
I've always had a piece of me that liked excitement and change and travel and new adventures. And this was definitely the big adventure of my life.
Now vacation time has come to an end. Gotta get back to my studies again. Make good grades so I can pass. Said school is in at last. School is in. Oh baby, school is in. School is in. Oh yeah, now school is in.
I still recall this incident in elementary school. I was at a predominantly white school. I was in my homeroom, and a teacher from one of the classes that I had, she asked me what happened to the pencil box and a desk I was sitting at. And to me, that was outrageous, because I would never, it was never even a thought. I never thought that people would steal. And she asked me in a very incriminating manner, what happened to that pencil box? At that point, I knew something was wrong. And I knew that because I was the only black student at that school, that she was accusing me of stealing from a desk that a white student had sat at.
My fellow Americans, I'm asking for your help to give a chance for every child to be educated to the limit of his talents. Not every child has an equal talent or an equal ability or equal motivation, but they should have the equal right to develop their talent and their ability and their motivation to make something of themselves.
We moved to Atlanta when I was 12. We lived in West End. That was a very, very poor place. Tiny houses, dirt roads. It was like the other side of the railroad, you know? I'd never brought anybody home. They never really knew who I was. Inside, it was just closed off. Didn't trust myself. Didn't see myself. I couldn't see myself very well. There weren't any real reflections around. I just had a tremendous amount of shame inside, and I hated being that poor.
This administration today, here and now, declares unconditional war on poverty in America.
So why do you lie down? And baby, let your mind roll on.
Yale started the Yale Summer High School in 1964 in response to Kennedy's call for equality in education and later Johnson's war on poverty. And Yale's thought was that the best way it could do its part in the war on poverty was to identify these talented minority students, bring them onto the Yale campus, and expose them to the inspiration that they felt Yale would provide. When I graduated from Yale, I knew I was interested in going into teaching. And a friend approached me and told me about this opening in this program called the Yale Summer High School. My title was Associate Director for Follow-Up. And one of the things I did was find Yale alumni who could help the kids readjust after the summer program, you know, to their difficulties in their home or school situations. When Larry Parris came on as director in 1967, the situation in the country had changed considerably, and we were faced with the task of creating a program that could address these issues.
I came on in 1967 to the Yale Summer High School off of a situation in New Haven where I'd been a cause celeb involving the Vietnam War. I was chairman of the history department at that time and decided that I really wanted something else, something different. And the opportunity came up to become director of Yale Summer High School. 67 was just a prelude to what was really going to happen in 68 when things really exploded fully. And I just knew that the summer high school could not continue in the same fashion as it had been for the previous 4 or 5 years. Something radical had to be done. I turned to Jonathan Hall and I said, let's create something that's central to the school that really speaks to some of the issues both on students' minds and really addresses some of the things that are going on outside as well.
In 1968, I was an undergraduate. I was a junior at Yale, and it was one of the most crazy years of my life, and I think of the 20th century. We were in the middle of the Vietnam War. We were in the middle of both the civil rights movement and chaos in the cities, and Martin Luther King is assassinated that year, and the country explodes. Cities are in riots, the country is torn apart. And in the midst of all this, Larry Parros and the Yale Summer High School are assembling all these amazing high school kids from all over the country and bringing them to Yale, to the Divinity School campus, to talk about the human condition and about race and about who they are and about where we are as a country and to read the classics of the Western canon. And it was amazing.
My mother came by and she brought everyone into the living room and said, okay, everybody sit down, and nobody knew what was happening. And so she said, Jesse, what do you plan to do? And I said, with what? And she said, well, with your life. I said, that's probably exactly what I said, just like that. And she said, well, you're going to Yale. And I said, oh, yeah? Really?
I remember thinking this was the most beautiful place I had ever seen.
You know, it was a magical kingdom. Here was a place that had these beautiful Gothic structures and brick buildings.
The architecture was like nothing I'd ever seen before.
Driving up Prospect Hill was just overwhelming. Then to see the Divinity School campus.
I remember going to the Divinity School. I really felt this is not some place that I belong. They found out who I was. They're going to throw me out of here.
The level of curiosity about what was going to happen to them during this brief time was immense. They really had no idea what was going to be expected, how it was going to evolve, what was going to be demanded of them.
What was in the back of my mind is, oh no, you know, I think they have the wrong person. It just looked like that I was at a place where I didn't belong. Too big, too clean, too perfect.
The first time I took a shower in Yale's main gym, I asked somebody if they had any soap. They said, soap, man, hit the thing on the wall. It's got all the soap you need. I was in a whole nother world. A whole nother world that showed me possibility and opportunity that showed me things that I would never have otherwise seen.
I wasn't sure that I knew how to act. Because, you know, you walk around and there'll be these common rooms with these overstuffed, you know, leather chairs and these large portraits of deans and presidents, and they're all dark and sober looking in their robes.
They had a reception, and I didn't drink either. And so there was a bar, and someone said, well, what do you want? I'm thinking, I don't know any drink. I don't know what to drink. And everybody was ordering drinks, and I heard somebody go, a scotch and soda. So I said, I want a scotch and soda. I thought that was the nastiest thing I'd ever tasted.
I think the third or fourth day I went there, they took us to the Yale University Library, and it was like a cathedral. It was like, oh, my God. And then we had this little cart, and I'd say, oh, they got a first edition Edgar Rice Burroughs Tarzan of the Apes. And I can get this book? So I ordered it, and then when the day it came, somebody came to the summer high school campus and hand-delivered this thing, said, it's there, you can come and get this book. I said, me? And I went to get the book, you know, and I'm afraid to take it out of the library. You can take it. I'm afraid to take it out of the library. I read it. It was Edgar Rice Burroughs, the first edition of Tarzan of the Apes, you know.
I'd stopped in New Haven to spend some time with a seminary classmate of mine and his wife. They had a picnic to go to with this guy named Larry Parris, who was putting together an educational program at Yale. This whole business of experimental education, educational innovation, was something I'd never really wrapped my head around and thought it might be interesting to have some first-hand experience. Larry offered me a job and said, yep, I'd love to work at the summer high school.
If there's one question I think that I'd really like to have the students have an opportunity to address here at the school itself, it would be, what am I good at and what makes me feel good? I think for the most part, traditional schools are constituted in such a way as to not allow students to address that question adequately.
I was born on a sharecropper farm. We were poor, but I didn't know we were poor because of, we had everything that everybody that around us had. When I moved to North Carolina, Wilmington, at the age of 8, I was staying in the projects, but I didn't know there was projects at that time.
I was born in Puerto Rico, came to Brooklyn when I was 5 years old. On my way to school, I had to step over drunks and there were addicts in the hallways, you know, and shooting up, but I was never afraid. I never thought of it as being bad. It was part of the background, the environment.
I was born and raised in Chicago. I lived in the Henry Horner Projects, which have now been decimated. That whole area was an overflow from the South Side. My whole memory of that time is in some ways a contrast. Very loving memories of the neighbors and playing and childhood friends, and at the same time, an environment that had lots of challenges.
I came from a large family. I was one of 7 children. We lived in a reservation town, Rosebud. The state is bisected by the Missouri River, this huge, ugly river that kind of goes nowhere and just plods along, never changes. It's just a great land of nothing.
School never seemed relevant to my life. It never seemed to be something that would take me anywhere. It was something that I did. I mean, I didn't know really why I was there.
By the time that I got to high school, there were different tracks. There was an academic track for kids that wanted to go to college, and there were vocational tracks for kids that college was not for them. I remember talking to my guidance counselor, Mrs. Shapiro, at one point, and him trying to counsel me not to pursue an academic track. He said, you know, Algio, you know, you come from a poor family. You know, how are you going to get into college? Who's going to pay for it? You know, you're going to need to go to work as soon, if not before, you finish high school.
I remember having an argument with my mother, and I said, you know, when I graduate, and she says, what makes you think you're going to graduate? Our people do not go to school. The women in our family get pregnant, then they leave their husbands, or their husbands leave them. And you're going to be just like me. And I went, oh, no. No, 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 I'm not.
People used to tell me I was stupid and dumb all the time, and I kind of believed it. And I thought that I just knew things because I had a good memory. Take the textbooks, I read the whole thing, and then sometimes not even go to class or get a job after school, and then come in and ace the test. And teachers get angry because you didn't do the homework, not doing the line of course. But I was bored.
School wasn't my focus. Very few teachers ignited me intellectually. It wasn't that I couldn't learn it. If I liked it, I learned it. If I didn't like it, I didn't do it.
It didn't pay to show that you had smarts, you know? You do just enough to get by. You pass the test, and of course, you make a C. That's good enough.
I cut school. I think the number that somebody quoted was like 147 days. I probably would have not graduated from high school had I not gone back for the summer of 1968.
I remember a fella, he was a good friend of mine, and he came out in the corner one day and he was saying, you know, when I'm all dressed up in a suit and I'm going downtown to my office, you guys will be going to the factory. And I remember saying to myself, not me. I'm going to be one of the guys dressed up in a suit going downtown to my office.
It was in the 10th grade that one of the guidance counselors came up to me and said, you know, Aldo, there's this program up in New Haven, and it's called Yale Summer High School, and I think you would really benefit from going there.
I was sitting in my biology class, my 10th grade biology class, and somebody came in and said they wanted to see me at the office. I knew I didn't do anything wrong, so what's this about? I'm never called to the office. And I get to the office, and there's this recruiter from Yale Summer High School, and he tells me about the program, and I'm like, that sounds interesting. I mean, I'd love to be involved in that.
They brought three of us up to the principal's office, and there were three separate envelopes with our names on them. And each student was allowed to open their own envelope and see if they were selected or not.
And as other friends of mine were saying, well, the paper says sorry, 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 sorry. So I didn't really pay mine any attention. So later on that day, so I happened to look at mine, and I mean, it was lo and behold, the thing said, congratulations, you've been accepted. And I mean, it was just, I was flabbergasted.
I kind of felt like I didn't deserve it because I knew I had just been goofing off in school, you know. But, I mean, they had the right guy. There was no mistake. So off to Yale I went.
Another part of my job was admissions. And the kids tended to be categorized in terms of winners or losers. The guidance counselors, who were most often responsible for sort of pre-selecting the kids I would interview, were also somewhat influenced by these categories. When I went out into the field, these categories made no sense to me. I was looking for a very different quality, which both winners and losers could have, which was a certain questioning attitude and a quality of awareness that I thought would let these students discuss the issues of contemporary society.
I first heard about the Yale Summer High School when I overheard the principal call these five guys out. His representative from Yale University was coming to interview them for the Yale Summer High School. So I went to the library and looked up an encyclopedia about Yale University. So I said, oh, this is interesting. Then I had other thoughts about how I could possibly become one of those five. When Jonathan Hall came to interview the five guys, I cut my classes. I knew he had to go to the bathroom at some point. So Mr. Hall came out, went to the bathroom, and I was right there, and I told him, you need to talk to me. The letter came to the school. The principal had not opened it. She waited until the assembly to open it and had these five guys sitting up there. They just knew one of them was going to Yale. And when she opened the letter, she turned five shades of red. She said, Willie Lewis. And the counselor looked at me. The boys turned around and looked at me. And the rest of my classmates clapped their hands. When they announced my name, the first thought that came to my mind was, you took a chance by going up to him and talking to him when he was in the bathroom. You really, really took a chance.
I think they were thrilled to have been chosen. They felt unique, that out of everywhere in the country, they had been chosen to participate in something thrilling, different, demanding. And having been chosen, they lived up to it.
The very idea of getting on a plane terrified me. I had never been on an airplane. I had asked my mother to call and see what she could do to get that plane ticket converted to a train ticket or a bus ticket or something. But she was adamant that I was to have this experience.
So this was the first time that I would ever leave, you know, outside the radius of, you know, 50 miles outside of Chicago.
I was very apprehensive about leaving New York. I remember getting on a bus to go to Yale Surma High School, going into New Haven, and just being afraid, just thinking, what if I get there and there's nobody there?
I remember going to the airport and then getting on the plane, and I start to think in my mind, what the heck is going on here? These people are spending money to buy an airplane ticket for me?
I recall, as if it was yesterday, sitting on that propeller-driven two-engine plane with it revving up, getting ready to take off. Oh, my gracious. Like, my heart was about to come through my chest, but the very moment it left the ground, all those fears left me, and it was amazing.
Well, my first recollection of arriving at the Divinity School was I was in awe. But I said to myself, there's a lot of white people here. And I said, I have to find a black-friendly face because how is this really going to work out?
They told me, okay, this is going to be your roommate. And she's a pretty big black woman from Chicago. And I went, okay. And we looked at one another. We had our bunks. And the question was, who gets the good bunk? And I just remember going, I do not want to fight this woman. I do not want to fight this woman. I'll do whatever it takes. She can have it. I don't care.
This white guy from Appalachia was my roommate. I guess he had gotten there earlier than I had. And he had did his laundry, and he had hung his laundry up in the day room. And I said, this is not going to work. This is just not going to work for me. So I went to tell my counselor. I said, we need to make some changes because I don't think I can do this for the whole summer. So he said, well, just try. You know, you got to get to know each other, come from different backgrounds. I said, okay. So that's when I realized this is not going to be a summer of fun and games. This has got to be something different. And it was. Turned out to be something very, very different.
It was significantly different than any high school that I was aware of at that time. The class settings that we attended, definitely something very different than what I was used to. It always seemed so informal. I think we had about maybe 12, 15 in the classroom, if that many.
We sat around what I know now to be a seminar table. There were just all of these students and mentors or teachers around the table. And we would kind of go wild. We would express ourselves.
I like the informality of the classroom structure. You know, we might have class out on the lawn. You know, it might be a beautiful day. The instructor might decide to go right out there in the court and have class. And, you know, we're sitting there cross-legged, sitting on the grass, you know, having class.
No one got in your case if you just kind of relaxed in your seat and slouched down. Now, there was so much attention paid to those kinds of things. People were more interested in what you said and how you responded.
See, my classroom experience, the last thing in the world I would be thinking about when I went home was what information I had gotten at school that day. So that was the first time that I can remember ever really enjoying learning.
It's been a long and funny road. And what really came out of, you know, 10 or 11 years of high school teaching experience was becoming convinced of how inadequate, how inappropriate high schools are as institutions which profess to serve the interests of young people, that for the most part, high schools, rather than meeting the needs of young people, really exist for the most part to control.
I've been wandering through this land, doing the best I can, trying to find...
So in the summer of 67, I was given to understand that a new director was coming on, a guy named Larry Paris, who was brought on at the last minute. The program was all planned, and I was the one, you know, with the experience. So I remember him sitting down and asking me, you know, tons of questions. We had very much the same ideas about the kind of kid Yale should be working with. And so we began to talk about, you know, changes that should happen in the program. One of the most controversial decisions we made was to include women because we felt they would add an important perspective to the program. It was controversial because Yale was not co-ed. But not a lot could happen that summer because it was already May or June. Larry did introduce a few new things, mainly the use of therapy groups, I think they were called T groups then, where kids could talk about their, you know, feelings and personal issues.
The first day of class, we just sat there, and the teacher never started the class. The longer we were silent, the harder it was for anybody to say something, because what had to be said just had to be more important to break the silence. And that was the start of that class. So it was really an incredible course, and it's just not something that you see in schools anywhere.
We were actually talking about issues. These T groups were really vital because a lot of emotions came out that probably would never have surfaced if you didn't have an environment to make people feel safe and comfortable that they can do that.
We were allowed to get into issues, sexuality, race, confidence, lack of confidence, all of these issues. It's hard to label that as education, but the fact is, it was incredibly educational. It really exposed the soul of humanity individually.
The Yale Summer High School in 1966 and 1967 was a very exciting place to be. It's just that in 1968, something incredibly different was tried. A number of us had been using the so-called great books as we taught courses in the civil rights movement, and it must have just occurred to us, why not put this together and come up with a curriculum that really addresses what's going on in the world around us, Vietnam and the civil rights movement.
People were aware that things were not going right. There were the assassinations and the racial violence. Larry and I think, were mutually committed to designing an educational program that would address in an effective way the issues of these kids and allow them to grapple with them.
The 60s were very different for black people or people of color than it were for many white people. And I think that there was a cultural divide about that, because to a certain extent, the 60s meant for many white people free love, free drugs, free sex. And for black people, for many of us, it meant just how do we struggle against this elephant in the room that we call racism.
Everything was changing consciously, the way we dressed, the way we thought about ourselves. I remember going to New York and seeing a black man with an afro and growing my hair long.
I became a bit more focused on the issue of black people as we relate to other people, not only in this country, but in other parts of the world. You know, I think it was 68, James Brown said, "Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud," you know?
So in high school, I began to organize myself and began to organize my fellow students. We literally shut the school down. We were down, it's a small New England town, and we were down on the green passing out leaflets, asking for things, and there was no violence. There was no bottles being thrown or rioting. It was a peaceful demonstration, but we on our own left school, and the other children, white kids, left also. And I got labeled a leader of that situation, and I was expelled from school.
You know, at this time, yeah, I think I was forging some kind of political consciousness from what I'd been reading, which were, for the most part, fairly left-leaning publications, but I didn't really relate it to my own situation. I related it to African Americans' sympathy with, you know, with the civil rights movement, but naively didn't even relate it to conditions where I was living with the Sioux kids and the Sioux population.
I would say in 1967, I was a product of a racist culture. Did not consider myself a racist, but I'm sure I did racist activities. I had friends that had maids, and the maids had a separate set of dishes that they were allowed to use. They had a plate and a cup and a glass and a fork and a spoon, but they didn't get washed with the people's plates, and everything was done separately. So it was just the environment that I was in. I hadn't thought about it, and I will say, I think most people would say I was a racist, and I'd say I was a Southerner.
Everything in 67 was much more low-key. The summer of 68, everything had changed. I mean, people were starting to think differently.
Larry was trying to pull everything together, trying to make sense of the world, trying to make sense of the direction of the school, trying to bring together a lot of complex issues. It seemed as if the value had been taken off of education and placed upon bringing the students up to par with what was going on and doing something about it.
The politics of the day was the predominant thing, you know. I mean, we did our class work, you know, but everything seemed to get back to what was going on in the world, and things were heating up.
On campus, it was in your face. Different ways of handling things. The ideal that things could be tackled from different perspectives.
We dealt with some of the most difficult and traditional academic works that can be studied, and they were studied in a chaotic way because we were dealing with chaotic problems. And thank God they were dealt with in a chaotic way. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been dealing with the problems that we were purportedly addressing. I had been pretty much a great books person from my undergraduate education. I don't know of any occasion where something as conservative as the great books approach to education was applied to something as radical as the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement as they were known in 1968.
399 BC, the death of Socrates. You are there.
I was very surprised at the enthusiasm that all of us had for reading the classics.
I remember reading Antigone. The first time I took the book back to my room and I looked at it before I opened it up, I said, Antigone, I wonder what that's about. You know, that's where I was. I mean, I Greek and Roman studies, it was Greek to me, you know.
So we were exposed to philosophy, we were exposed to Kant, to Hegel, we were exposed to all of these wonderful ideas, the Enlightenment.
I remember these were the first days in which I remember my brain burning. Today, I only get that from cayenne pepper. It was a hot environment for me intellectually. I mean, I didn't even know I had intellect at the time.
Discussions of personal and communal responsibility, these rose right out of what we were reading. And the fact that they were being reflected in the greater world around us was never lost on any of us in the room.
Our tears for our country's troubles are deep. But deeper still is our confidence in the future and our ability to meet and master man's basic problem, how to live in peace.
What may have been most unique about the curriculum of the 1968 Yale Summer High School was the notion that blackness and whiteness cannot be understood inseparably.
What's the matter?
And this is where we used the ideas of Hegel and the concept of the master-slave relationship and the struggle for identity.
That race was chosen as a vehicle for us to you know, to study academically, you know, I think was genius. Because I think as a young person, it was the theme of the times in 1968.
In a sense, America has gotten used to this racial divide in a way that you try not to pay attention to the way that someone might have a limp. We've become accustomed to it. We try to ignore it. We don't want to draw attention to it. And at the same time, if you don't accept the reality that it exists, then in some ways it becomes worse.
In most schools, dealing with controversial issues is forbidden, as Larry Parris found out. You know, if you try to deal with the really hot issues of the day that touch people most deeply, people get excited, and that particular kind of excitement isn't welcome in most schools.
We have these penal colonies that go under the guises of being called educational institutions in our communities, where kids have to walk in with metal detectors, make sure they're patted down, that there's no weapons. It's unbelievable. It's out of control. How, as a society, have we learned to accept this?
I think what was present in 1968 that's not present now is a sense of hope.
1968, people were beginning to question the authorities. They were beginning to say, we will not be treated this way anymore. People were starting to demand their rights. People were outraged. Today, where's the outrage?
Remember Huckleberry Finn, we read, and somebody wanted, you know, talked about burning it, which the majority of the students just said, why would you, let's talk about it. Why would you want to burn it? What do you find offensive in the book?
It wasn't just an intellectual conversation. It was people were pissed off. You know, the whole campus was in an uproar. And wherever you went, people, you know, that was a discussion for like a week.
I can remember it got deeper than just questioning it. You know, we had a bonfire, you know, and people burned the books. I can remember that because it had nigger Jim in it. And we didn't want to sit in the classroom where the word nigger was being expressed so openly, especially in front of white people.
I've gone a long way since I seen you last, ma'am. And the further I got and the more human beings I met, the more I got to feel that no human being has the right to own another human being. Human beings make enough mess out of their own lives without messing another human being's. That's why I'm asking you to please let Jim go free.
Larry said that this was not Nazi Germany, that no books would be burned on his watch. It was first and foremost a school. But I don't remember, were any books burned?
I mean, a lot of the arguments that I saw happening were really silly to me. And there was this kid who thought that he was God's gift to the black militancy movement and knew nothing, okay? But anything white had to be bad, anything black had to be good. And he whipped the campus up into a frenzy over Huckleberry Finn being a racist book.
I was against Huckleberry Finn being included in the curriculum because of the racist language in the book. I was a 17-year-old who knew everything.
Okay, just because a book you never read before, because it had the word nigga in it, okay? And where I come from, you hear nigga every day, okay? Because you know that's where not to go. I mean, that's sign. I grew up in a world where there was signs saying you nigga, black now can't come here, white can't come here. It wasn't inferred like they did in Waterbury, Connecticut.
And I actually called people names, white people names, because they thought that they knew what needed to be in the curriculum.
There were times there when I think even the director, Larry Parris, felt that it may get out of hand.
I remember Larry saying, did he write the word nigger in the book to piss off Melvin Jones in 1967, 1968?
What's the purpose of banning Huckleberry Finn? Some kid from a bus stop in New Hampshire may never know what the racist Segregated South was like if he didn't read that. He didn't know where we came from, where we have to go.
Just seems to me you got to be prepared to live with that kind of tension.
And the truth of the matter is, those students needed to engage in that kind of discussion and action that comes from the gut. That's got to happen before there's learning. That's a part of the learning.
What was interesting was, is nobody backed down. There was a great discussion, a lot of emotion was let out, and the book was read and discussed by all.
One of the highest compliments you can pay to a book is to say that it deals so seriously with what I'm concerned with that I won't even let anybody read it.
There were so many avenues and so many things to discuss that a 17-year-old Melvin Jones did not realize that needed to be discussed. And I think that's one of the legacies of Yale Summer High School for me. You don't have to be afraid of anything. You don't have to be afraid of the word nigger, whether it's written or said out loud. You don't have to be afraid of somebody trying to take away your rights and your responsibilities. That you need to stand up for something, but you don't want to become a brown shirt while you're standing up for something.
My first home that I bought, a bedroom community just outside Atlanta, an awful lot of blacks were moving in, an awful lot of whites were moving out. My next door neighbor who stayed there, Mr. and Mrs. Manning, Mr. Manning drove a red pickup truck with a Confederate flag on the front, which caused a lot of consternation for some of my African-American neighbors. Mr. Manning still referred to African-Americans as colored. I never found the word colored offensive. Got along splendidly with him as a neighbor, learned a lot from him. Like to think he learned a few things from me. But were I to have said when I moved in, we got a tobacco-chewing redneck with a Confederate flag on the front, I think I would have missed an opportunity to know a very, very nice person, his wife and his son. Go figure.
If we're honest in terms of what the educational experience is about for young people, we absolutely have to be prepared to take those kinds of risks. If we're not prepared to take those kinds of risks, we are saying to young people, I don't trust you. I don't trust, you know, where your own thinking and exploration will take you. And therefore, I want to, in a sense, program what your education is about.
Larry was trying hard not to be judgmental while running an institution that fit inside Yale University that had a different way of functioning, a different way of looking at the world, and bringing in youngsters who would not normally be on Yale campus.
You know, the critique of the Yale Summer High School was that it was messy, that it was kind of anarchic in style. The kids were confronting themselves and each other and the big ideas, and that was a different way of conducting things than Yale's mission, which was to select and train and put on the right path the future leaders of America.
I think Yale set up the summer high school with the best of liberal motivation. Yale thought it was doing a good thing, and that meant that we would give people an opportunity that they hadn't had before. In return, they should accept the opportunity in the precise framework in which it was offered.
But Yale Summer High School was supposed to be an enrichment program. And it was academically, but that was the extent of the enrichment. My first summer, we were like robots. We were given a script, and we had to follow the script. The summer of 66, the creativity was not there, like it was my second summer. It wasn't there.
Yale had a deep commitment to educating 1,000 male leaders a year. So if you perceived of yourself as somebody who wanted to be one of those 1,000 male leaders, you were welcome. But if you questioned that definition of leadership, or you perceived yourself outside of that in some way, that wasn't something that Yale thought it was particularly good at dealing with, or something that it even should deal with.
One of the things that did trouble me was the push for us to negate our past, to become these future preppies. It just didn't sit well with me. It didn't sit well with me.
The flaw in that form of education generally, not just for disenfranchised people, is that it doesn't accept people as they are, and it doesn't accept that they bring experience to the table which can inform the institution as a whole.
I think Yale Summer High School was looking for potential in a way. Certainly Yale University talks about potential, but really they want some demonstrated potential before you get in. And certainly, I'm sure Yale Summer High School was looking for that, but not in the way Yale University was.
I am a young woman of 17 who is greatly concerned with the going-onness of history and about what it means to be a black student in America, the world, and the universe. Adults find me interesting, a bit cynical and rash, but willing to cooperate in order to get the job done. I am threatened by authority if its existence is not necessary or adequate for a particular situation. I am independent and decide which rules I can break safely without causing damage to my future or my stance.
One of the things that has always been closely tied up with the concept of the Yale Summer High School is diversity. Diversity in the people, diversity of experiences, diversity of geographical location.
It was an interesting mixture of people because we were thrown together with people we ordinarily might not have come in great contact with. And I think it challenged a lot of us in terms of what we thought our own prejudices were, what we perceived to be other people's prejudices. But because we had to live with each other, we had no option but to try and work it out.
Tonda was the roommate that was assigned to me. She was very different from me. She, in some ways, perhaps symbolized some of the things that I would be fearful of, someone who had a little bit more abrasive and somewhat militant tone to her voice. And yet, in confronting those things, I had to realize that I had a lot of stereotypes and prejudices that I needed to let go.
I saw the value of dealing with other children who were not like me, background-wise and racially and whatnot, and listening to the things that they wanted to say and finding value in what was important to them. And I think they did the same thing with me.
We all learned from each other because we all brought our own perspectives to the program. We all brought our own backgrounds and our own life experiences, such that the learning that occurred there took place both in the classroom and outside of the classroom from the mere interaction of all of us.
I remember Floyd Ballesteros from the Ajo Desert telling me that he got up in the morning and the first thing he would see would be lizards looking at him. And I don't think I've ever seen a lizard other than somebody at the zoo. Then you had like Emma Wesson, who grew up in the South. To me, I always thought her perspective was kind of fresh and innocent.
I remember one of the students, Algio, who was a Puerto Rican from New York. I had never seen a Puerto Rican before. I had really, all I knew were black people and white people.
There was a kid who was from Indian reservation in some place, I don't even know where it was at the time, whose parents were both drunk all the time. And we just sneak books into the house, okay? And me and this kid, we go to the movies together, we stay up all night talking together, wait till the tutor went to sleep, and then we get up in our room to talk all night together. It was like we came from the same place, okay? And there were redneck guys, okay, from Louisiana, okay? And they lived that same life, too. I said, how did you find these kids, okay?
Give your love to all, see yourself grow. Don't be tired, learn to live right.
What made the Yale Summer High School work was people who were deeply concerned in their role as educators, deeply concerned in their roles as citizens. And we had a group of teachers who had the talent to take two very different kinds of things, the literature of the great books and the problem of race in America and somehow brought those things together.
Initially, Yale had almost exclusively selected tutors from the Yale-Harvard axis. In 1968, we had very different criteria. We were interested in looking for a kind of teacher, a kind of tutor who could work with the kinds of students we had and were as concerned as our students about the issues that were important to us.
I am very much interested in working with students with whom I feel a certain affinity. This feeling of identification stems from the feeling that I suffered under the same sort of irrelevant and custodial-directed education as they have in high school.
The teachers were only a little bit older than us generally, but they gave me the impression of competence. I know that I was almost immediately persuaded that they knew what they were doing, that they were doing what they wanted to do. They wanted to be there, they wanted to be teaching these students, and they were connecting with us in a way that was unfamiliar with me.
It was a 24/7 educational experience. All of their values were being imparted to us over something as simple as eating dinner or eating lunch with them and talking about Antigone or the guys in the ballet class.
I think the kids felt that the faculty was learning, that the tutors were learning. And that alone is so gigantic a difference that almost never occurs in a public high school.
I spend a lot of time in situations where I'm either physically different, maybe even religiously different from the rest of the people. I think Yale Summer High School was sort of my bridge from a segregated world to a more multicultural world. And in that case, it really prepared me. I faced some things that I never faced before in my life. For instance, in growing up in the South, you never talked about homosexuality. At Yale Summer High School, we actually talked about it, and one of the students even talked to me about his attraction for me. The macho reaction to this is beat him up, right? So, but now I'm the tutor, so I had to figure out how to navigate that. I actually remember that conversation with that student about it and making a point to him that, well, that's not where I come from, but doesn't mean we can't still have a relationship as a tutor and student. Yale Summer High School helped me develop that perspective. You know, it's what Martin Luther King calls mutuality. I cannot be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. And that, so that sort of connectivity. So I can make connections to people that people don't think I could identify with simply because they're human beings.
There's got to be something in the educational experience that opens the door to an understanding of one's own humanity, certainly the humanity of others, that has to do with something more than just simple access and the opportunity to make a bigger paycheck than the next guy.
The Yale Summer High School took academic subjects, critical thinking, analysis, logic, philosophy, history, and made it relevant to me and to the other kids that were there.
It was just such a thrill to introduce young students to books they would never have dreamed of reading. They would have thought them dry and impossible. And when they actually tried reading them, they found them exciting.
I can't remember whether it was a discussion of Sophocles or Hegel or who it was. But sitting in a classroom, hearing this great stuff being talked about in terms of F this, and so-and-so didn't give a S about that, and blankety-blank this, and blankety-blank that, to begin to realize, damn, these kids are reading this stuff with incredible clarity, and they are speaking of what they're reading from an honest place within themselves and that sense of having that freedom.
I think the most exciting work we used was Jean Genet's play, The Blacks. That play has some of the most militant black rhetoric that anyone could encounter anywhere. Our black militant students, the same students who were unwilling to read Huckleberry Finn. They just loved the black rhetoric of Genet's The Blacks.
Zah homie, Negroes from all corners of the earth, come back me up. I was the African queen.
The play, I think, resonated with us. We were African Americans wearing white masks, and then below were sort of the people, the folk.
I don't remember much about the staging and directing of Genet's The Blacks. I think the first time I did it with young people was at Yale Summer High School. It wasn't that easy to do, I must say, but I was well pleased when we got to the dress rehearsals because lighting was ready and things were ready to go and they looked good. They were so excited they wouldn't dare not to cooperate.
He kept encouraging me, and he says, you have to do it this way, and this is how I want you to feel when you're saying your lines, and, you know, come on, I know you've got it in you, you know?
I have only one photograph from that summer. It is of a beautiful black boy with an enormous smile, and it is my student, Anthony Lewis. He was a delight because there was a teasing that was going on, clearly. The looking out the window, the pretending not to hear, and his usually keeping his hands underneath his shirt. He could have been considered misbehaving, but he was thoroughly connected to the class. They were connected to each other. I was connected to them. So there was really no chance that he was going to escape me or them. And the fact that he was always there suggested he really was involved.
We were all there together, all there for a common cause, and that was to incite, produce, generate experience. We learned just as the students learned.
I think of the people and the music that Bill Barnwell introduced us to, the way he taught us to listen. I remember he loved us. He loved us. He loved being there. And he loved us as individuals and as a group. And it was a contagious feeling.
I'll never forget the Newport Jazz Festival watching Dionne Warwick, who was at that time in 68 at the peak of her career and was my favorite performer. Because I had never been to a concert like that, coming from Wilmington, North Carolina. Here was about 50, 60,000 people out there. My hometown only had 50,000 people in it.
It was unbelievable. Me sitting in an audience and famous performers and someplace I'd never been before. This is not just Pittsburgh. The world is very fascinating. A lot of venues, a lot of opportunity.
This wasn't common stuff. This was way out of the norm for a little black boy from Mississippi.
What they wanted to do was to teach us how to move in different social spaces. If we want people to be comfortable in spaces that they usually don't have contact with, then we have to introduce them to the spaces and make them feel as if they have a right to be there.
And the interesting thing was, just about everything we did, even outside of the classroom, was really brought back into the classroom.
The other thing that strikes me was this incredible intellectual energy, this incredible looking and searching and challenging and thinking with a sense of freedom to pursue our ideas.
We were encouraged to let our thoughts kind of run wild, to let our fancies run wild, and to challenge one another. And that was a real departure for me from what I was accustomed to in traditional high schools.
I mean, why would we come to New Haven, Yale Summer High School, to have the same experience that we were having at home? You know, it seemed to me that if it had been structured the same way, it would have been counterproductive. You know, we needed a different experience, and this was a different experience.
There are several differences between Yale Summer High School and Yale University. The student body is different. You know, the admission criteria was different. The willingness to experiment. I spend a good deal of my time trying to cajole, encourage, tease my students toward getting engaged because I want people to understand that learning is not simply someone lecturing to you, you know, for something, pouring something into your hair. It's an interactional process.
At Yale, there are a lot of suppositions about the limitations of how people's experience and values should be explored. And I think that was the fundamental conflict between Yale's vision of what a summer high school program should be and how the program was attempted to be run in 1968.
Modern university is the cradle of the nation's future. Today, it not only preserves and transmits knowledge and values, it has been called the chief energizing and creative force in our entire social system. Let us not underestimate the task we face. The underdeveloped peoples look to us for training and guidance, and our own governments look increasingly to the universities for expert counsel, and for scholars whom they can borrow to staff posts of high responsibility.
The Yale Summer High School was supposed to be a cram Andover, Exeter, Groton, rather than accepting the students for what they bring to it. I think it was part of a broader conflict in educational theory, and it got polarized around the issue of race, because that was the theme that was adopted for the summer high school in 1968, which to me was a subject matter in which larger issues were dealt with. But that wasn't what the Yale administration really wanted.
Many young people were turned on by the curriculum because they were talking about these issues both inside and outside the classroom. But I think it's a difficult dialogue to have at Yale University and across cultural boundaries.
Even in 1968, race, for the most part, still was a taboo subject. I mean, you had a lot of black people talking about race amongst themselves, and you had a lot of white people talking about race amongst themselves, but you get in a mixed company and you don't talk about it.
I think part of what happened with the summer high school was the opportunity for students to understand that the issue of race is all right. It's open, it can be talked about. It can indeed be the subject of conversation, not just in classroom formats, but in terms of relationships that sometimes did and did not get established.
I had never done that before, being in a maybe all black class. You know, I'd never heard what white people thought, never cared what white people thought. You know, but this was probably the first opportunity that I got to hear, you know, white people express their views about black people and our concerns.
I kind of identified with the blacks to a large degree. I mean, we had the same issues in many respects, you know, poverty and no hope.
The thing I do like about the environment at Yale and race is that it was always up and open for discussion. You didn't have to hide or assume or allow your prejudices to drive your relationships. You could always talk about it. And over the course of the summer, I think a lot of us were able to sort out what was real and what wasn't.
I remember the black kids in the gymnasium playing basketball, and they would play with no shirt and long pants with cuffs. And it was so hot in that gymnasium that their cuffs would drip sweat like they'd been swimming. And you have to realize, I mean, there's a great book, The Invisible Man, that, you know, we had blacks in New Orleans, but they were pretty much invisible. You really didn't see them. So in this culture, to see these, you know, these black bodies dripping with sweat and very good at basketball, I never was an athlete. I was better at cigarette smoking at the time. But it was really something.
I think I fancied myself as something of a leftist at that time, and it was very important for me to be perceived by the black kids as a cool white guy. I don't know if I succeeded in that at all, you know. I'm sure they saw me as just a Midwestern dork, you know, but I didn't care as long as they didn't think that I was racist or anything.
That's America, 1968. These kids have assembled to talk about race. It's a hopeful idea. There was a kid at the Yale Summer High School. He was an African-American student. He was from somewhere in the South, like South Carolina. And it was a high school that had a marching band. He decided he was not going to go back to South Carolina and play Dixie because he read Antigone by Sophocles. It's about what is loyalty and to whom is one loyal.
Ούτε φαντάστηκα ποτέ πως οι διαταγές σου θα έχουν τέτοια δύναμη, ώστε να μπορείς εσύ, ένας θνητός, να ξεπεράσεις τους άγραφτους και ασάλευτους θεϊκούς νόμους.
What impressed me about Antigone was the fact that she was willing to stand up for what she believed in, to take a stand, even if it cost her life. And I found myself facing the same situation. Things really changed, you know, when I came back to Carolina after being at Yale for the summer. You know, I began to say, you know what, I got to take a stand. And one of the things that really hit me hard was the playing of Dixie, because I was at an all-white school, and I was part of the band, and we only had two black students in the entire band. And they loved to play Dixie. They would wave the Confederate flag, and they would sing, they would shout, and sometimes even tears would come in their eyes. But for me, as a black person, Dixie was very offensive. I thought about Antigone, and she took a stand, and I decided I would take a stand, whatever way I could. And so what I did, every time they played Dixie, I would just sit down. And it worked. To my surprise, five other white students joined me. Even the band director stopped playing Dixie for two football games just out of respect for me. I don't think it was in vain. I did take a stand for something that I really felt in my heart, and a few people did get the message.
The question of whether we can invent again something that brings us to a more inclusive, a more egalitarian, a more happy version of who we want to be is exactly the work that we're doing now. Now, I came to the Michael J. Perkins School. It's a school that was built for poor children and has served different generations and different ethnic groups of low-income families since it began. What sustains me in this job is the work that we're doing is big. The rejuvenation, the reinvention of quality urban public education in the 21st century. And my vision of what education really should be grew out of seeing this example and saying, you know, that's what we need. And I'm still in my own way trying to recreate in a small elementary school in South Boston some of the vision that I encountered as a 19-year-old in 1968 at Yale Summer High School.
We are poor little lambs who have lost our way. Ba-ba-ba.
I think that there was an institutional sense by 1968 that in a lot of areas Yale had to assess what it was committed to. Yale was unwilling to use its resources to try to explore educational opportunities which could be more inclusive and could deal with issues that large numbers of young people felt were important to them.
So here's the summer high school, which is actually bringing together kids consciously representing the diversity of America and opening up that discussion, which is exactly what those of us who were undergraduates wanted at a place like Yale. That didn't fit this very narrow mission, which was to produce 1,000 male leaders a year.
In this time period, Yale hired a guy named Art Singer to sort of evaluate Yale's role insofar as it involved outreach to disenfranchised constituencies, which Yale had not historically met. That became a context in which the Yale Summer High School came subject to evaluation.
I can understand people who were anxious about Larry Parris's style of leadership, about the tenor of the program. I can understand on the part of some folks that this is not the kind of thing that can be quote-unquote associated with an august institution like Yale University.
Yale Summer High School was all over the place. There was nothing about it that I would call neat.
I think that there's a good deal of messiness that's required in education. I tell my students that if you're not uncomfortable, you're probably not learning.
It was a night in July. We had invited a busload of girls from the Connecticut College Upward Bound program to the campus for a mixer. Things proceeded rather nicely, and then at the end of the evening, the girls were just sort of standing around talking with a lot of our guys and with our own girls, when all of a sudden, along came the campus police. They immediately sensed trouble. They stopped right in front of where the kids were gathered and shone their headlights on them. You could almost feel the tension rise. It was a really difficult situation. The kids didn't know what to make of it. They could sense the hostility of the police. All of a sudden, out of the shadows, emerged Tonda. She grabbed me by the arm and said, "Larry, come with me." She stood me right in front of the headlights, and she grabbed me in her arms and planted a kiss right on my lips. Everybody burst out laughing. The tension just lifted, and the kids sort of dispersed at that point, having had their laugh. The cops revved up their car and pulled away. Tonda really saved the evening.
The energy of the summer high school in 68 was nowhere in the world like that of other schools. I think it's that business of having freedom, freedom to think, freedom to use your mind, freedom to talk to other folks about the way in which you read and take in and react.
It was in that environment that just cooked my juices in a different way. That's when I put down Edgar Rice Burroughs and picked up Franz Fanon, who was a psychiatrist from Martinique, who worked for the French army during the Algerian Revolution. I was 17. A year later, that connection was called the Black Panther Party of the Temple Program, okay? Which I didn't even know existed at the time. The courage to do that, and the intellectual certainty to do that, is something that happened to me that second year of high school. I was becoming somebody that was gonna do some things I thought were very special later on in life.
That's probably the travesty of my experience at Yale. I couldn't appreciate which direction you all were trying to get us to go in. You know, Tony and I talk about that a lot.
Other people would go to the room and study the books, and we'd be somewhere goofing off. But I mean, you know, we were kids. You know, I mean, we were kids, so we had a lot of play in us.
You know, it took a lot of endurance to hang out there that summer, emotional endurance. I just remember that last week of just being tired, but not wanting to leave.
So I think the school was spearheading a whole different method of education, and because of the people who were there, you had some kids that had to erupt because they were going to erupt no matter where they were, and I don't see how you could have controlled that.
Someone had said they had gone in, like, and destroyed the bathrooms, and they were knocking holes in the walls and stuff like this, and I remember asking, why? Why are you doing this? They were angry because they had to go back to the same old thing. They felt really free at the Yale Summer High School. Now we have to go back where we're going to be afraid, and we're not going to feel free. And so their only way of going was to lash out. They weren't lashing out at each other. They were lashing out at the establishment.
Things got really crazy about 3 days before everybody was to go home. Class schedule was pretty much thrown into a cocked hat. And everybody sort of walked around in a daze, sort of realizing it was coming to an end. And there was an incredible sense of sadness and tension. The nights got really crazy. Fire alarms would go off at 2 o'clock in the morning, and people were thrown in the showers, and parties were held in anticipation of the end.
And I can remember the emptiness that I felt the day that I had to leave. Man, it was a feeling, even when I talk about it now, I could feel, you know, it was like, man, I've been living with these guys for 8 weeks. And a lot of these guys I might not ever see again. You know, and the thought of that was just so frightening and painful.
I don't remember the anger at the beginning of the summer, but I do remember the anger at the end of the summer. We brought together a group of kids, and we gave them a different life, and then we just sent them back.
When it hit us, it was like, damn, we got to go home. You know, I mean, shit, this gonna be over. You know, now what?
I really don't know what the future holds for us. In one respect, I feel very excited about what the possibilities are for us, for the idea, for the process. I guess what perhaps for me is the most sobering thought of all is the fact that no matter what we have done or have not done here will not ultimately be the basis for the decision as to what happens to the project.
Just 8 short weeks ago, I stepped off a jet plane, excited over my first plane ride and my first trip to New York alone. My knees knocked and I was filled with awe. I was going to Yale University. I came searching for something, some strange intangible force to transform me. 8 weeks later, the body is basically the same, give or take a few pounds, a long haired beard, but something inside of me has changed. I realize more and more each day, something new in me. Some new unexplored aspect of my character.
I emerged from the program with many new phases added to my life. My entire personality was changed and rearranged.
I learned a lot of things about myself, other people, and the world with my newly awakened senses. You gave me a look at beautiful people, and most of all, I was given a look at myself.
I was lost and unhappy. I didn't have an identity. I was no one. But Yale lifted me into the bright and happy feeling of knowing. Knowing about life and a peaceful mind.
It's kind of hard to express the feeling. It's how a baby feels when he first stands up by himself. He now can see a lot farther and a lot more. But the safe ground seems so far away. It's a strange experience, standing alone. Even though it scares you, you feel this is the way you're supposed to be.
After I was completely inundated with the Yale summer high school experience and started to feel real great, I was thrown out of it. The perfect analogy, birth. The warm, secure dribblingness of the womb, and then presto, cast out into a cold and unlovely world. Returning was a horrendous, sad experience. How I wish something could be done or changed.
Yale Summer High School, what a bomb.
You hear it ticking for 8 weeks.
You can hardly wait for it to blow.
Then boom, it's all over.
Here's a solution to the things that the whole country is solutionless about, and Yale shuts it down. So we go and we ask the administration, what's the reasoning? Why is this program ending? And they say, oh, it's all based on a report that was done, the Singer report.
The report was not made public.
Wait a sec, you've just made a real public decision and we're members of this university, we're students here. Why is the report secret? And then a friendly person who shall not be named gave us a copy of the Singer report.
That became the context in which we at the Daily News became involved, because we didn't see why everything shouldn't be on the table and wondered why this wasn't.
The Singer Report said directly in print, Yale is elitist in its basic design.
And that the goal of any admissions process should be to find people who would adapt to the values of the institution, and let's have a few more Latinos and a few more blacks and eventually a few women participate in that and become part of this leadership class. But the implicit assumptions of the leadership class were not open to questions.
And that was what Yale existed for, and this summer high school didn't fit that model, and so they were ending it.
I don't think it was anything personal with respect to Larry Peros. It was just Larry Peros and his vision didn't fit into Yale's vision of itself as it had evolved by that time period.
But, you know, we really thought, we were so naive, we really thought
We were not only going to change the lives of kids, we were going to change the way people thought about education and schooling. We were going to change Yale University. Oh, yeah. We were going to change the world, you know, and...
Well, we had a right to do it. We did. For a summer.
Frustrated underachiever, been underachieving for all of my days. They sent me to Yale for to get motivated, so when I return home I'll get me all A's. God bless the Office of Economic Opportunity and the Science Foundation for whatever they do. Bless Boolean algebra and advanced composition. And God bless the running water too. Now as I walk through that great square at Harvard, I thank dear old Yale for providing the means of reaching my exalted position, chief washer and keeper of greens. So God bless the Office of Economic Opportunity and the Science Foundation for whatever they do. Bless Boolean algebra and advanced composition. And God bless the running water too. I am a frustrated underachiever, been underachieving for all of my days. They sent me to Yale for to get motivated, so when I return home I'll get me all A's. So God bless the Office of Economic Opportunity and the Science Foundation for whatever they do. Bless Boolean algebra and advanced composition. And God bless the running water too.